got very good arms.
He didn't fall? Inconceivable.
You keep using the word. I don't think it means what you think it means.
Welcome back to Thinking Critical. This is Wes. And in the news recently, it appears that Greg Land is once again being accused of plagiarism, basically using someone else's art and maybe changing a few aspects about it. And here with me to talk about that is an independent comic book artist himself, Timothy Lim, Poe to Stump himself. How you doing?
I'm doing swell. Thank you very much, Wes.
Well, I'm glad you could join me today, but I got to say this. Today is my fifth wedding anniversary, and I want to dedicate this video to my very beautiful, very lovely wife, who's put up with me for well over 7 years now, but in holy matrimony for 5 long years. It's probably been hell for her. Without her, I could not have this channel. I consulted her when I wanted to start it. She's been supportive every step of the way, and she's definitely the best thing that's ever happened to me. So, baby, happy anniversary. I hope you enjoyed this video. I know you like Tim. So, Tim, this is not the first time that Greg Land has been accused of plagiarism, but this time, apparently, he is repurposing some of the art from Tristan Jones, who has worked on the Alien Predator franchise in the past when they were under the Dark Horse licensing. Obviously, that has moved over to Marvel now that Marvel acquired Fox. They wanted to get their rights to the Alien Predator franchise into Marvel Comics. I know you saw the pictures. Is this a big deal? It seems pretty bad to me.
A couple of things. So I guess to clarify for the listeners out there, so he did used to work for Dark Horse doing the same brand. Is that correct, or am I misinterpreting things?
Yes, he works for Dark Horse. He's Australian. He's actually out of work. He had to take a day job because he hasn't had much work yet. But he was the illustrator on Alien and Predator before Marvel took the license over.
So this is interesting. This kind of throws a wrench into things because I did not know that. But my background, for a lot of people who might not be familiar, I actually did work for merchandising for about 10 years. One of the licenses that we worked for was Marvel. And what is interesting about the Marvel licensing brand is that there are things when you're doing any type of merchandising or artwork, there is a kind of understood, how do I put this? You have this repository of images where it's understood that if it's something that has appeared in any property that Marvel has owned, that there is leeway in terms of what granted access to and that you can use. So for example, let's say you're doing a comic with Spider-Man in it, and let's say you have on the television, there's a news conference. The artist, in theory, could borrow from, let's say, a Daredevil comic, an image that appeared in a book that's not drawn by that creative team, and use that because it's kind of a shared repository of files. Right. So when I was working in merchandising, there were some times where there would be like, hey, your assignment, you're not drawing anything this week. What we need to do is we need to have this cover artwork appear on a t-shirt. But the problem with it is that this arm is extended way too far off the side. Is there any way that you can redraw like the arm so that it's tucked under so that we can fit on a shirt? And it's like, okay, well, I'll do that. And it's the idea that you don't have to get the artist's permission because you're borrowing from something that's already owned in company. So I'm not trying to defend what Greg Land did, but there's also that to consider. I don't know what the behind the scenes legal status is of any of those images that when Marvel bought out the license from Dark Horse, did that also include the use of all of the imagery that came before? And what is the stipulation as far as what the artist did? It would almost be one of those things where if he did borrow from Tristan or swipe from it, it would almost be better legally to just have used the image fully than to kind of finagle with it. So that's part one. Part two, though, is that I think what throws a wrench into things is that Mr. Land has had kind of a reputation as being like a swiper. I mean, there's three terms that we use here. You have plagiarism, you have tracing, and then you have swiping. Tracing, obviously, is when you basically copy it pretty much as is from the original source. Plagiarism is probably a more broad topic term, just looking at anything that looks like it's a mimicry or copy of something that's existed before. And then in swiping, which I think is more common in industry practice is when you're using a reference and it's kind of an obvious reference where there's a thin line between embellishment and flat out tracing that's going on here. And I think it's arguably the latter that's happened with the swiping. And it seems like that's what Greg Land has done with it. Now, I'm playing devil's advocate here because even though, yes, the images do look very, very similar, it's also this idea of the combination of the details that occur in it. Obviously, I think if this has occurred, Greg Land, he does do a few tweaks in terms of where the striations and where some of the musculature and defined details are. But obviously, I think Tristan has a very strong argument in terms of how similar his work looks to the newest work by Greg.
You know, as an artist yourself, have you ever went through and seen someone that had clearly taken your art, used it as inspiration, or, you know, as you called it, just flat out swiped it or took it and try to sell it off as their own? Like, what's that feel like?
It's annoying. Like, it's really annoying when you see it. But there's also this thing of, my gosh, like I said, I'm trying to go through kind of all these legal things that people think about. There's also the idea of parallel thinking. So sometimes people just might have the same idea for the same subject matter appears that way. It would be one thing, for example, for if he had just swiped it wholesale, where it was the same pose and everything. And Tristan did something interesting where he said, well, it essentially is the same pose if he took the arm and he swiveled it up to a different position. And it's like, okay, that's, you know, that's interesting because he obviously didn't do it directly, but there is that embellishment that happens there. Just, you look at Star Wars, for example, if you have like, or Star Wars or Spider-Man, Spider-Man probably more specifically, if you look up Spider-Man poses on Google Images, you're going to see a lot of repetition. And I think that the argument could be made that, well, you could accuse someone of swiping, but on the other hand, it could just be the fact that through Spider-Man's storied career, there's been a lot of poses that he's had. And you're going to run into a couple of repetitions simply because two artists just happen to have the same idea. I think a more famous example is the whole like sit on the throne. So you're going to notice like Dr. Doom, Black Panther, Namor, if Batman, I mean, sitting in the Batcave, you'll start noticing some similarities. And it's probably because when you think of someone who's sitting on a throne or in that position, you're going to have some overlap in terms of how many times it's been done. I'm not trying to defend Greg Land here. People can look up the storied accusations of, you know, his supposed swiping that's happened in the past. I'm just trying to throw a different way of looking at things. But I think that in this case, I think the reason why it's popped up is because of the history that he's had as far as these accusations are concerned.
Well, also, Tristan said that he took the image, popped it into Photoshop and was able to put it over his original image, and they like snapped together.
Yeah.
Now the head's different. He's definitely swiveled the head and he's re-illustrated that, but the pose of the body and the hands like basically essentially fit perfectly together.
Yeah. So in Photoshop, there's a snap function, which is essentially kind of this automatic tool where it looks at it sees what you're trying to do. And it tries to make an estimate based on that. So for example, whenever I'm trying to resize a building to perspective, it'll snap it based on where it thinks I want it to go based on other objects I have around there. So in the case of what he did with his artwork, he took that arm, he re-swiveled it up because he thinks, hey, I think that he just took the arm and just changed the position of it. And when he changed it, it snapped to where it thought it was, basically like a transparency on top of where the new artwork was. That was interesting. Now, I think there was an update in that article. I think he actually found where the head came from too. So after much digging, I don't know if it was his own artwork or someone else's, but he found a xenomorph head that corresponded to the one that Greg Land drew. So I thought that was an interesting development with that as well.
Well, you have to feel bad for Tristan. When he talks about his story, you know, he's had to take up a day job. He can't do full-time illustration now. Because Dark Horse lost the licenses, they bring it over to Marvel and they give the job to Greg Land. And then he's essentially repurposing the image that he already drew, and he's getting paid for it. And this guy's, you know, struggling to make ends meet down in Australia. Like, I'd be pissed off too.
Yeah, that sucks. I mean, it's bad. And like I said, me personally, I've not been able to prove it. I've never really thought I wanted to go through a legal hoopla to try and show any type of malfeasance. But yeah, when you start noticing stuff like that, it is really irritating. And I read the story that he was going through in terms of where he is in his situation, and I think it sucks. But like I said, a lot of it is going to be based on, the argument is going to be based on, I guess, proving a malfeasance has taken place as opposed to a strange coincidence. And I think if it was a one-time thing, the latter would be probably more apropos. But again, when we're looking at someone like Greg Land, again, I don't know the guy. I don't want to cast aspersions where they don't exist. But he has had a storied history of supposedly swiping from people. And so I think that there's some credence that should be paid there.
That's a weird history. Yeah, he's definitely swiped like pictures and used them for a couple of series of Marvel. But he's also really well known for taking like porn star faces and then like putting them into his comics. He's actually admitted to that. But I think that's pretty strange. Like,
I did not know he admitted to it. So that's interesting.
According to the Wikipedia article, I was actually looking for another source for that, but I ran out of time before we get in there. But it says that he acknowledged it.
I didn't want to mention it because I didn't know how family friendly you wanted this stream to be. But I remember the first time I saw it, and I thought the funniest thing was, so someone had taken this huge gaggle of images, and they found like the corresponding images to go with it. And I just thought, okay, that's interesting, because I don't know who would look at that and be like, I've seen that somewhere. Like, it was this.
That O face looks familiar.
Yeah, that looks familiar. I just thought, I read a couple of books with Greg Land's art in it, and there was not a single time where I just thought, that face looks oddly familiar. Like, where have I seen that before? But this guy just went through like a master sleuth and was like, that image came from here. That face came from here. That position came from here. And I just thought, wow, that is either some serious detective work going on, or there was a series of coincidences that happened. I mean, for example, like using references is not, it's not something that should be frowned upon, because when you need to know, let's say, how a mouse looks like when it's screaming, you're either going to go on Google Images to look that up, or you're going to use a mirror and see how your own face looks like. So when I was seeing these pictures pop up where it's like, oh, here's Sue Storm and she's screaming, but guess what? It was swiped from this, you know, maybe pornographic image. I just thought to myself, well, I would have never thought that, because I was like, how many times are you going to Google a woman's face screaming and come up with it? But what they did was they did the same thing, where they just took it, superimposed it over the art, and been like, oh, it's the same person, the same face, the same layout, even where the teeth are, look like they're in the same position. So it's like, I don't know what to say to that.
I don't know, as an illustrator yourself, somebody that's done a lot of work, like I said, since you were doing commercial art, you know, for t-shirt and stuff like this, I'm sure that you had to use known poses for that art, whether it be Star Wars, you know, Spider-Man or whatever. Does it bother you that there's a guy out there being hired by the big two, big name, probably gets a good, pretty good page rate, that's out there swiping images for somebody, other people in the industry that are struggling right now? Do you think Marvel at some point should be like, he's probably plagiarized enough, probably doesn't need to be at Marvel? Does that irk you that they still hire this guy?
I think it would boil down again to the legal ramifications of
not legal, like just on a like a principle thing.
I think it boils down to Greg Land's prior history. As I said, I think if it was like a one-time thing where there would be no malfeasance to be proven, then it could be chalked up to just a crazy coincidence. I'm not saying that it is coincidence. I think in this instance, I'm siding with Tristan, because I think that given the prior history,
overwhelming evidence.
Yeah. I don't know. You know, we talked a little bit before we started about how kind of the industry works and kind of the camaraderie that happens. I mean, I use the word incestuous, to be honest. So in terms of them, I think that people would have to know kind of his history, as in terms of, this is not the first time that this accusation has been leveled upon him. So it's like, well, what were you thinking? And did they know about it? I don't know. I can't postulate on any of that. But as far as how annoying it is, yeah, I mean, I do agree that it is very annoying.
If I was an artist, I would be like, why is this guy, why are they still hiring him? He's screwing over other artists. you know, give somebody else a chance. I would be annoyed, but I can see why they do it. If he can meet deadlines, there's not a lot of really good artists that can really meet deadlines in the comic book industry. We see that happen time and time again. If he's easy to work with, we see that a lot of comic book artists can be a little bit persnickety, maybe not the easiest going people in the world. So maybe he has that going for him. But if I was an independent comic book artist and this dude was still at Marvel, still stealing other people's work or repurposing it for his own financial gain, I would be annoyed that they keep hiring him.
I think a better compromise would have been to do an homage, because this is common and it's something that is just understood and respected, or at least maybe not respected, but at least tolerated. You have, for example, McFarlane's Spider-Man cover. Take your pick. I mean, like, basically every, it's been copied so many times, but typically everyone knows that it's an homage or kind of a parody or satire. And so you'll put something like in the corner that says, like, you know, Joe Smith after McFarlane. And it's this idea of, hey, I'm aware that this is a pose that I think is really cool. I think it would look good on the cover. We just repurpose it with my character. And it's almost, you know, depending on how some people see it, it's flattering because it's...
Hey, Bobby Carlin did it to himself for Spawn 300.
He did, exactly. But the other thing that can happen too is you could always contact the person and say, hey, just to let you know, there's some art that we're going to be repurposing. I just thought I would let you know and try to come as close as we can as possible to kind of recreating it so that it's a facsimile that everyone is happy or content with. So, I mean, that's another thing that could have been done in a situation like that. But again, like I said, I know you don't want to hear the legalese of it, but it could have just been like, hey, here's a repository of works that you're allowed access to if you want to copy it.
I imagine they have access to all that stuff. You know, Marvel has been releasing omnibuses of Conan since they took that license back from Dark Horse recently. They've been doing the Star Wars like epic collections, and it has all that old Dark Horse stuff in there. So I imagine when they got the license back for Alien Predator, they probably got access to all those images.
Right. So like I said, that doesn't make it right. I'm not saying make it right at all.
But yeah, it's just weird. You know, you always hear these allegations. It's come up once again. I do feel for Tristan and his family. You know, he obviously had put a lot of hard work in. Greg Land saw his image and thought it was great and wanted to recreate it for the new upcoming Marvel Alien series. So I feel for Tristan. I'm sure that he would like to get compensated for some of that, and I would be pissed off too. So I'm in Tristan's corner here, but there's probably nothing he can do about it. It sucks.
Yeah, and I'm definitely in his corner as well. I'm just, like I said, I'm just pointing out kind of the side, I think, because I think a lot of people would be like, well, how does a person get away with it? And it's like, well, there's a lot of ways that people get away with it. Some of it boils down to a legal aspect, and some of it boils down to basically being able to prove or disprove any type of coincidences happen. But I think that sucks ultimately. And when you showed me those pictures, I just couldn't help but just giggle, because I'm just like, well, here we go again. It's another case of swiping or plagiarism or tracing, if you want to choose your words as far as semantics are concerned.
Hey, Marvel, if you want somebody that can draw original Alien artwork that's really good, probably cheaper than Greg Land, there's a dude in Australia that used to work on the franchise, you're copying his art right now. Why don't you just give him a call? He could probably take it over. He could use the work. He's probably earned it.
I think that is the one point that I'm glad you brought up. I think that's a big plus. I think that is also the frustration, is the idea that if this was a clear swipe, like, you know, ultimately 100% beyond a shadow of a doubt, why not just hire the original guy? He worked on it, right? Like, that's not... That's
he needs to work.
We work in a remote society as it is, because of the whole craziness that's been happening. You have everyone's pretty much working from home. This guy, who cares if he's in Australia? He can get the work done. Why get someone who's going to copy or ape that when you can get the real deal, the guy who's done it before?
Yep. He's clearly up for it. Hopefully Marvel gives him a call. I think he probably deserves the opportunity. Did great stuff on Alien in the past. Tim, thank you so much for joining me here today. I had a fun time talking about this. And obviously, I enjoyed giving a little shout out to my sweetie. Been with me for 5 years now. Well, legally, at least. And it's going to be an exciting day. Hopefully, everyone has an enjoyable weekend. There will not be any Comics Aficionados this Saturday. still going to be celebrating my anniversary with my wife. There will still be some content, maybe not as much as normal. Also, Tim has his own YouTube channel. He and his creative partner, Mark Pellegrini, it's called The Bunder Dome. They do live streams and things like that. And there will be an opportunity probably right now where you can select an icon, go to the channel and subscribe. They have a lot of good content, a lot of cool stuff.
Thank you very much, Wes. And it's always a pleasure to be on your show and on Thinking Critical, and much success to your channel and to your marriage as well. So to your wife, I'll say, Maingat kayo, salamat po.